you're an athlete or you're someone that works out. So you know that your body is a machine. So you look at intermittent fasting a little bit differently than other people because you have other things that you have to factor in. You're not just here for weight loss. You're not just here to look good. You still want to perform well. And honestly, it was a viable concern of mine. So before I was 300 pounds, but before I was 300 pounds, I was an athlete. I was an all-state rugby player. I was a track athlete. And this kind of stuff like confused me. I didn't understand from an athletic perspective how intermittent fasting would work for me if I was overweight and I still wanted to be able to strength train and stuff like that. But it all made sense as I started going through it. But anyhow, I've laid out a really detailed video here. So I'm gonna break down what you need to pay attention to if you're an athlete with intermittent fasting, but then I've taken the liberty of creating example days for you so you get an idea of the schedule. So here on this side, we'll talk about what you might wanna do differently from other people that are intermittent fasting. And over here, we'll talk about just giving you some ideas for timing. Now, there are all kinds of walks of life when it comes down to athletes, right? Strength athletes, power lifters, CrossFitters, endurance athletes, all with different goals, but we can still play the same general kind of timing game with a couple little nuances. So I'll break down anaerobic versus aerobic and things like that. I promise I won't get really complicated. I'll keep it high level, but there is going to be a lot of information. So just sit down, grab your cup of invisible popcorn if you're fasting, and let's go ahead and jump in. But first hit that red subscribe button and then hit that little bell icon because you don't want to miss the videos that we are pumping out lately. Okay, so the first thing, very, very first thing, no matter who you are, you really need to try to get in the habit of conducting your training during your fasted period. And I start with this because it's probably one of the most commonly asked questions. I'm an athlete, should I still train in my intermittent fasting window, even if I'm training at an elite level? The short answer is yes. Why? Because it's all about adaptation. It's called the hormetic effect. Imagine, it's like training with a weight vest on. Then when you take the weight vest off, you're faster and you're lighter. If you constantly train in a fasted state, sure, you might find it's just like an iota more difficult. But what's wrong with that? That's the purpose of training. It's metabolic adaptation. You're just getting adaptation to occur at a cellular level, which is just wicked cool. Because now, when you do come time to actually train, your body is going to have the ability to survive when other athletes are just running out of stamina. It's really powerful. So your body has a unique ability to become what is called dual fueled. Because you are training in a fasted state, your body magically learns how to use ketones for fuel. It doesn't matter if you're eating keto or not, that's irrelevant. Because you're in a starved state, your body gets used to utilizing its stored energy, so then it has the ability to run on its stored energy or exogenous energy coming from food. So the point is here is then when it comes time for competition, then you add a little bit of calories in. Then you add some fuel in and your body's like, whoa, okay, usually I'm used to training fasted. You just gave me a quick shot in the arm. Now I'm Superman. Okay, it's just like training without supplements. And then the first time you ever take a pre-workout, you're just like, whoa, okay. And then after a while it wears off. Keep yourself fresh. If you were an endurance athlete, however, I recommend that when you do go into competition, you fuel with fats, okay? So if you're a strength athlete or you're anaerobic, doesn't matter if you're keto or not, prior to your competition, you may want to add some carbs just so you get that extra energy. But if you're endurance, it's a whole different system. Your body runs on the aerobic. You are better off to train fasted, but then before your marathon or anything like that, have a little bit of fat, have some coconut oil, something like that, okay? Again, I have to keep it a little bit high level because this is a big video, but you get the general idea here and you're smart, you're an athlete, you can probably figure that part out. Okay, so next up, endurance athletes that are doing intermittent fasting, I strongly recommend you do keto and intermittent fasting because endurance work generally utilizes fats much more. You're out for a run, you're using beta oxidation and ketones for fuel, whether you're keto or not. So you might as well be keto and get your cells more adapted to that. So endurance athletes really get a huge benefit out of doing IF with keto. On the other side of the equation, anaerobic, if you're a strength person or you're an athlete that does a lot of quick bursts of energy, you're a track athlete, football player, anything like that, you absolutely can do keto. I honestly don't think it'll hurt a whole lot, but it's not necessary. Okay, because the benefits of the intermittent fasting regimen for you are coming from the fact that you're getting, again, that hormetic effect, that stress effect, but you're also getting the keto adaptation that's occurring just by training in a fasted state anyway. So it's not really that much of a concern for you, although it is doable. It can go either way. My point here is that it's just endurance really needs to go keto and IF, anaerobic can go either way. Okay, if you are training for competition and you really feel like, okay, at some point I am going to have to compete or anything like that, I encourage you to still do one fed workout per week. So here we're talking about conducting your training in a fasted state, but I recommend that one day a week you still eat before a workout. Okay, and the reason for that is simple. One, you remember the feeling. What I don't ever want to happen to you is get so used to training in a fasted state that if you do eat before a workout, you feel like total dog garbage, right? You just don't want to do it. The other thing is I want you to be able to test the timing out. If you're, you know, concerned about competing, let's just say you're a football player, let's just say, make it simple, let's say you're NFL, right? You're training throughout the course of the week or the off season, you're training in a fasted state. Well, then all of a sudden it comes time for game day and you've got the highlight because you got Monday night, you've got the Monday night highlight this time. And you're like, well, I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna eat because Thomas said to eat. Okay, well, you eat a half an hour before and you're sicker than a dog because you've never done it before. Point is if you test that out, you'll know your timing and you'll know, I know from experience, I need to eat 2 hours before and then I'm fine, then I'm golden. Okay, it's all about learning again, you're an athlete, you're all about your data, you're all about your testing, test this stuff out. Okay, metabolic flexibility, also important. We want your body to know how to operate fasted or not fasted. The recommended time is gonna be 2 hours prior, just so you know. This is important if you're focused on strength training only. Okay, if you're focused on strength and that's just your goal, you're a power lifter, I'd be okay with you doing half of your overall workouts in a fed state. Okay, so whereas most of the time I'm recommending conducting your training fasted, if you're really focused, strongman competition, powerlifting, pure strength, you don't care about body composition, okay, you don't care at all, half your workouts are okay fed because I want you to get that extra strength because you're going for how much weight you can push, and I get that. Then I need you to avoid the following, okay? These are things that break the hormetic effect. Branched chain amino acids, I know you love them because you think that they help you maintain muscle. I will tell you, when you're intermittent fasting, trust me, you have enough in the way of ketones in your blood that you are not breaking down muscle. If you go longer than 16, 18 hours, then maybe, okay? But in this case, you're okay. Do not consume BCAAs, do not consume glutamine, and get rid of the pre-workouts because they are full of amino acids and full of other things, maltodextrin, stuff like that, that will break your fast. You don't need it. But what's okay? Creatine monohydrate is okay. Why? It's not doing anything metabolic. You're putting something that's already in your cells just in a larger abundance. You're fine, and newsflash, it doesn't matter if you take it in a fasted state because you're not getting an instant result from creatine. It's cumulative, it takes days. So take it whenever you want, it really doesn't matter. Okay, and then beta-alanine is a great pre-workout, that's okay to take. And then citrulline malate, also okay to take. It has an arginine effect, so I'm okay with those. And then caffeine, of course. Caffeine pills, coffee, green tea. I love my green tea. I do concentrated matcha green tea because I get so much effect from that. I'll take it and just put it in like a little bit of water and pound it, it's amazing. Okay, here we move on to some slightly different goals. If your goal is recovery oriented, okay, if you know that you're going into a workout where it is important you have maximal recovery, let's say you're doing a big full body workout, a big training session, it's counterintuitive, okay, but this is what it's gonna be. I need you to allocate your workout to the end of your fast. I'll say that again, if it's a big workout, you need to allocate your workout to the end of the fast, and it's the opposite of what you think. You think that you want to be as close to fed as possible for your bigger workouts. But no, I want those workouts towards the end of your fast because that way you're closer to breaking your fast at the end of the workout so you get the maximal recovery. We've been told for years and years and decades that we should eat right after our workout in order to stimulate protein synthesis because of insulin sensitivity and all this stuff. There is merit to that to some degree. Now, you do get a little bit more out of it right after a workout because you're insulin sensitive. So why not put your bigger workouts at the end of your fasting period so that when you do end your workout, you also have the luxury of being able to eat right after your workout and get maximal recovery. Recovery happens with the meals after the workout, not with the meals pre-workout. So it makes no sense to work out and do a hard workout earlier in your fast because you're trying to have more fuel. Important thing to remember is this rule maxes out at a 16, I'll even say 17 hour fast, okay? The point here is that I never want you to train at the end of a fast if your fast is longer than 16 or 17 hours. If you've been fasted for 20 hours, you should not be working out unless you have very specific goals. I do it, but I'm weird. And I do it on some, you know, I have some purpose for it, body composition, metabolic adaptation. I'm saying, if you're an athlete, there's no reason for you to be training after that 16 hour fast period at all. No reason. I don't see a reason unless you're trying to go for a challenge for yourself. I will say right now that if you're looking for foods for intermittent fasting, Thrive Market is probably the best place for you. So the cool thing is Thrive Market was built upon health foods. So the whole idea is like catching on with intermittent fasting, the ketogenic diet, stuff like that, and providing good foods for those dietary protocols. The neat thing is I've got a good partnership with Thrive Market. So they're an online grocery store. So you can go there and get all kinds of groceries, but I've been able to create Thomas DeLauer intermittent fasting specific boxes and keto boxes and thyroid function boxes, all things based on sort of the health guru stuff that I talk about. So if you're doing intermittent fasting, you might want to check out some of my intermittent fasting grocery boxes where I put specific items in that bundle. So they're a membership based online grocery store. So you do like 1 month options. Anyway, it ends up being cheaper than the grocery store. So check out the link down below in the description. You can check it out after you watch this video because I'll give you more details on foods and things like that. So you might want to be able to apply that when you head on over to Thrive, but definitely recommend you check them out and check out my intermittent fasting box. And if you're doing keto, check out my keto boxes as well. So don't forget that. Okay, now let's go ahead and let's move into some other stuff. You do not need to eat post-workout. And I know I kind of made some sense of that already with what I previously said, but I know that there are probably a few of you watching this video thinking, I've always been told I need to eat after my workout. Well, I just wanted to let you know there are multiple bodies of evidence that show that protein synthesis stays elevated for 24 hours after a workout. So you're not missing this ideal window. Okay, what you are missing out on is potential insulin sensitivity, but you're not hurting yourself by waiting. So the point is if you get up in the morning and you want to work out first thing in the morning, but you're afraid to because you don't break your fast for another 6 hours, you're fine. Trust me, that's generally how I work out. And I've managed to maintain a fair bit of muscle and even put on muscle. So I think you're totally fine with that. All right, and then very important, if you follow my other intermittent fasting videos, which by the way, if you're watching this and you're already a little lost because you just don't know where to begin, I recommend you check out my complete guide to intermittent fasting and check out some of my other intermittent fasting videos that are, I'll put down in the description because I have a ton of them. And that might help you out in getting a starting point. But you always want to have a small meal first, a small little lean meal right when you break your fast, then 30 or 60 minutes later have your larger meal so you're not bombarding your system with a bunch of nutrients all at once, okay? It's always about having the small meal and then the large meal. And another thing, mega dose omega-3s. Take those omega-3s, eat those high quality grass-fed, grass-finished meats, load those up and just really want to have a ton of omega-3s. And it's all about protein synthesis. Omega-3s have been shown to stimulate protein synthesis literally by 50%. That means 50% more protein getting utilized. So after you break your fast, take a bunch of fish oil pills. I don't care, pop 10 of them. It's not gonna hurt you. It's just good quality omega-3s. But regardless, during the time that you are eating, for the sake of crushing inflammation, recovery, protein synthesis, general inflammation, just modulation throughout the body, you should be taking, in my opinion, 5 to 7 grams. That's 5 to 7,000 milligrams of omega-3 supplementation. I personally just believe that and I live by that. So now we have this general breakdown. Let's talk about the schedule for a second because this is important stuff and it's where people get a little bit lost sometimes. All right, so I have two examples here. Example one is going to be doing your workout first thing in the morning. Example two is going to be doing your workout at the end of the fasting period, like I talked about. So if you wanted to, you know, when I talked about pushing it towards the end. So here's your example. 7 p.m. the night before, you have your last meal. And then at some point after that, you go to sleep. Maybe it's 8 p.m., maybe it's 9, maybe it's 10, whatever. I'm just using this example. 7 p.m. is at least when you had your last meal. So 6 a.m., you wake up. 6:15, you have black coffee, black tea, black tea or green tea, with no cream or no sugar, nothing in it, no stevia, just keep it black, keep it simple. 7, maybe 8 a.m., you work out in your fasted state. That's it, straight up, simple. Then you finish your workout 8, 9 a.m., you have more coffee and tea. The polyphenols, the caffeine from the coffee and tea, actually mobilize fats and will help recovery and help modulate inflammation a little bit too, and help stimulate autophagy, which is that cellular recycling that we want anyway. 10 a.m., I want you to mineral up. Load up on magnesium, load up on potassium, and potassium, just get through new salt or low salt, straight up potassium chloride, cheap bulk supplement, get it on Amazon, put a little bit in your water, just load up on those minerals, because that's the only reason that you might feel like garbage, and I want to help you out with that. Then 11 or 12 p.m., you're breaking your fast. So it's really not that hard. You've gone 16, 17 hours at that point, and you have lean protein, okay? Lean protein, just 4 or 5 ounces of lean chicken, no fat added to it, or a protein shake. Now, if you're not keto, if you're not doing keto, you can add some high glycemic carbohydrates, like 2 or 3 rice cakes. Spike your insulin. It's okay at this point in time. You're so insulin sensitive, your blood sugar is gonna go up and it's gonna come back down, but that's fine. You're strategically breaking your fast and you're an athlete. You're not someone that's really worried about the GI as much. You're trying to just get timing down. Okay, then at 12:30, 30 minutes later, you have a larger meal. And this is where it's okay to add the fats in. This is where it's okay to add more carbs in. And this is where it's a little bit more okay for you to just to eat your normal diet. I don't want you to change your diet a whole lot. The most important thing is just when you break your fast. That's a cardinal rule. So 12:30, 30 to 60 minutes later, eat a larger meal. Straight up, start your normal, that for all intents and purposes is your real meal one. And then 3:30, 3 hours later, you have meal three, which is really meal two, because the first meal is just a quick pre-meal. Eat whatever you normally would. If you're keto, you're keto. If you're not, you're not. I'm not gonna go into detail there. 6 to 7 p.m., large dinner, large amount of food with dinner. Okay, because this is leading into your fast. If you wanna have some fiber, that's cool. If you wanna have some fats, that's cool. Again, I have plenty of videos talking about different meal strategies. And allocate your supplements to this period of time for the most part, with the exception of the omega-3s I talked about having earlier. Okay, load up on them, take your vitamin D, all your supplements should be coming at this point in time, so you have the maximum amount of insulin, maximum amount of bioavailability of supplements. Okay, example number two, very, very similar with how we start. 7 p.m. is the last meal, 6, and then we go to bed, 6 a.m. we wake up, 6:15, coffee and tea once again, 7 a.m., I put this in here, you don't have to do it, maybe you go for a light walk. On days that I work out at the end of my fast, that's what I'll do. 7 a.m. I'll go for a walk with my wife and kiddo, and it's kind of a nice break, right? It's like just still getting cardio, but another thing is it's mobilizing fats, which is never a bad thing during a fast. Always good because, again, saturates your cells with fatty acids so they actually get used to utilizing them. So that's all great. 9 a.m., mineral up. I call it mineralizing. That's when you take some magnesium, take some potassium in, have a little bit of caffeine, low ahead and caffeine up, have that coffee, have that tea, have the minerals, have the salt, okay? Because you are prepping for something, because 1 to 2 hours later, you're gonna be working out. You're working out just a few hours past if you were working out in the morning. You're just working out at the end of your fast. So what happens here, just to give it a little more context. So you work out from 11 to 12. At 12 p.m., you immediately have your post-workout meal, okay? You timed the end of your workout along with the end of your fast. So now you are fair game to break your fast and your post-workout with that meal. So if you're keto, a protein shake with 40 grams of protein, okay? And then 60 minutes later, a larger meal, whatever you normally would have, right? If you're non-keto, 50 grams of carbohydrates, higher glycemic, coming from maybe rice cakes, maybe corn tortillas, lots of different options there. I'm not giving you breakdown there. Along with 40 grams of protein. So if you're non-keto, you have carbs and protein. If you're keto, you just have protein. Okay, really simple there, but right after your workout, boom, wham, bam, thank you, ma'am, done, okay? Add fish oil. Normally, I would say never add a fat with a carb, but we're talking a concentrated amount where you're only getting a couple grams of fat, but it's all the right fat. So add maybe 2 to 3,000 milligrams of fish oil, 2 to 3 capsules along with this meal, no matter who you are, to help with protein synthesis. 4 p.m., you have meal number 3, 6 to 7 p.m., back to dinner again. Another thing that's important to note here, that's actually very important to note, is you don't have to intermittent fast every day. Okay? You can use this as a strategy 3 times per week, and that's usually what I recommend. And if you're an athlete, you may not want to fast every day, but the point is that here's your protocol in the days that you do fast. And those of you that follow just a general 16-8 lifestyle, then this helps you out immensely. So I do recommend, once again, you check out Thrive. I really appreciate it. It helps this channel out, but it also gets you some good stuff in your hands, and I think you'll appreciate it. But please do make sure you hit that red subscribe button, go ahead and like this video, and post a comment if you have ideas for future videos surrounding intermittent fasting for athletes. I thank you again for watching, and I'll see you soon.